Obviously
but
not.
But that scene made me go, oh, that's, you know, but just you see, kill it. If you're going to kill it, kill it. Don't
could
do that.
You watch the scene?
Yeah.
I couldn't even watch it.
Fair enough. Stuart, you know the scene I'm talking about, though, right?
Yep.
Yeah. All right, okay, without further ado, we're going to talk a little bit about the Oscars. Of course, the nominations went up today.
Yeah.
But before that, we're going to do the usual, the top 10, the UK top 10.
Indeed we are.
While you tap frantically. Now, before we do get into it, before we get into it, every time I go to do the top 10, he goes to me, oh, wait, before you do, have we anything to talk about before we get into it?
No. To be honest,
I do hate you so much. I feel like like Hammond in Jurassic Park. I really do hate that man. Right, without further ado, coming in at number 10, taking £502,235, it's Paranormal Activity, The Marked Ones.
Like I said, it's much better than Devil's Due. It's better than I thought it would be. It's better than the fourth and the third one in the series. The fifth one, they've just released a casting call for it, so they're asking for people to play specific characters in the fifth film, which is going to be out on October the 24th okay. of this year. They're also bringing back Katie as a character as well, so my guess is that they're either going for a third prequel, which will probably be a record for any kind of movies, having three prequels.
Star Wars.
With this one, it's like sequel, prequel, prequel, prequel. It's annoying. But I think they're going to be set after the second film, fifth Paranormal Activity film. But this is not too bad. It's the Latino spin-off, and it was just used as a stopgap.
Okay. At number 9, taking £755,719, Anchorman 2, The Legend Continues.
I'm not a fan of the original Anchorman. I don't like these kind of the film itself. I didn't find it funny, to be honest. Andy thought this was a bit of a letdown because he liked the first Anchorman film. Mm-hmm. He just found that this wasn't funny enough.
Okay. At number 8, £783,624, it's Mandela, A Long Walk to Freedom.
Yeah, it should have been a TV movie. Yep. What the director has tried to do is cram the entirety of Nelson Mandela's life into a 2 hour and 20 minute film, and it doesn't work because there's lots of areas that are skipped over. So Idris Elba is fantastic in it, and Naomi Harris, who plays Winnie Mandela, she's fantastic in it. It's just messy. It's very muddled.
Mm-hmm. Okay, our first new entry of the week comes in at number 7, taking £1,102,433. It's Delivery Man.
Yeah, the trailer makes this out to be a comedy.
Right.
And it is a comedy at the start of the film. But the more it goes on, the more it actually is more of a drama. And it's Vince Vaughn who finds out that he's a father of 533 children. 142 of them want to find out who he really is. And it's just a drama for the last, I would say, about 65, 70 minutes about them wanting to meet up with the father. And for the drama side of it, it works. It works pretty decent. The comedy side is just usual comedy jokes that you normally see from a Vince Vaughn film. But he's played his annoyances down to such a normal level that it's probably one of Vince Vaughn's better films.
Okay. It kind of reminds me of, do you know that bit in Knocked Up where Seth Rogen's watching Cheaper by the Dozen? And he's like, this isn't a comedy. This guy's had 12 kids. His life is over.
But it, like I said, for the drama part of it, for instance, he finds out that he's got a disabled son, and he tries to establish a relationship with this disabled son without revealing to him that he's the father. And he actually looks over a few of them just to see what they're like as children, and it's just nice to see how his character evolves through the film rather than just being the slacker that he is.
Okay, so it's not a bad movie then?
Yeah, I went into this movie thinking that, yeah, I'm going to see a Vince Vaughn film. It's going to be terrible. I came out of the film and thought, actually, that wasn't bad.
Okay. All right. Fair enough. Coming in at number 6, our second new entry of the week, taking £1,230,483, is The Railway Man.
Yeah. Andy was the one who saw this. He watched it and he thought, he was annoyed the fact that this came out the same week as 12 Years a Slave. Because he saw both of them and he was mourning on the shore on Monday and I needed to slap him because I had a really bad film to review and he had Railway Man and 12 Years a Slave. And he really liked Railway Man. It's Nicole Kidman and Colin Firth, and it's about Colin Firth who worked on a railway in Japan, I think it was, where he got tortured, and it's about just him reliving his torture that he went through. And Andy thought it was really well acted, and it's a very interesting film. It's just he needed a slap because he got to review two good films and I didn't.
Right, coming in at number five, £1,293,299. It's Las Vegas.
Yeah, Hangovers for OAP.
Okay, is it any good though? It looks good.
It's pretty average.
Okay, all right, fair enough. Still hanging in there at number four, £1,314,153. It's Disney's Frozen.
I love this film.
Did you like it? Did you like it too?
I have to admit, as much as I am 99.3% straight, I am a massive fan of musicals. Indina Mendez, the voice from Wicked. You see, yeah. I didn't know she was in it because it was a kids' movie. We just thought, Christmas Treat, we'll take them along. As soon as Let It Go started, I think it was Let It Go the first song she sang in it, in the movie. It could have been, which is up for an Oscar. As soon as she opened her mouth, well, the cartoon character opened her mouth, I had goosebumps. And I kind of nudged Carol across the kids going, it's Indina. So there's nothing wrong with that movie. It's perfect. Girls save girls. Love story doesn't have to be love. It poked fun of itself. I loved it. Sorry.
Okay, moving on.
I'm fine now. Thanks, Stuart.
Wow.
Yeah.
But you know, Stuart and me liked the same movie.
Okay.
That doesn't happen very often.
And to be honest, I'm sort of like with you when it comes to musicals, because last year, 2013, two musicals that was released, Les Miserables and Sunshine on Leith, were in my top 10 films of the year.
Have you had the chance to see Les Mis live?
I haven't, no.
Do it. Seriously. It is so good. The movie's brilliant, but see when you see that on stage, it's brilliant. I mean, I saw Wicked on Sunday.
I really want to see Wicked live.
Go and do it. If you can, go to New York.
Oh my God!
Shush, we're
talking. Stop talking, both of you!
It's linked to Frozen because it's up for an Oscar. So it's not only in the top 10, but it's up for an
Oscar. Tenuous at best.
It's better than some of my stuff.
Listen, Mr. Miyagi. Back off.
Wax on.
Okay, coming out number three. Taking £1,504,554, it's The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug, Smaug, whatever you call
him. Yeah, this is a Peter Jackson stretching one book, which isn't a very long book, into three films, when it should have just been one film, two tops. It still shows, it's too long, it's way too long. This film should have been 2 hours. If he was going to do that with them, making it three films, each film should have just been 2 hours maximum, not 2.5 hours. And I still think that the special effects are just way too over the top, and the sets are just too fake. It flows better than part one, but it's still nowhere near as good as the Lord of the Rings trilogy.
Okay. Coming out at number two, £1,938,805, American Hustle.
Yeah, this is an acting tour de force, because Christian Bale, Bradley Cooper, Amy Adams, Jeremy Renner, Jennifer Lawrence, they are fantastic in it. It's just a pity that the story is a bit mundane, to be honest. The acting, it carries the movie brilliantly, and there are funny elements in the film, and it's like I said, the acting is fantastic. It's just the storyline is a bit basic, and it's lacking any kind of punch.
Okay. Now, our final new entry of the week, coming in at number one, taking £2,511,349, is the movie everybody's talking about right now, 12 Years a Slave.
Yeah, it's the Steve McQueen film starring Chiwetel Ejiofor, who plays a slave who was kidnapped. He was actually a proper standard man, but he was kidnapped and put into slavery. His first master is Benedict Cumberbatch, who treats him much more like a human being. He slaves more better. And then he gets sold on because he has a fight with somebody at the place. And so his next master is much more nasty to him. It's got a fantastic supporting cast, Lupita Nyong'o, who's been nominated at the Oscars. She's just outstanding in the film, and just there's nothing negative I can see about the film. There is one scene in the movie which could have been cut, and it's about a 20-second scene, which is just the camera focusing on Chiwetel Ejiofor's character, and that's it. That's the only negative I can see about the film. It's an outstanding piece of movie making. It's a director who has looked at the source material and created something that's such a powerful movie that I think it's a film that might be even shown in schools in 10 years' time about slavery, about what actually happened to it, because it honestly, it's such an important film. It's quite harrowing and a really hard watch, but it's a deserving watch.
Okay. Right, what's coming up this week?
Wolf of Wall Street, which is the new Martin Scorsese comedy epic, because it clocks in at just over 3 hours. And Leonardo DiCaprio is in it as well. It's been getting a lot of buzz at the Oscars. It's up for quite a few awards at the Oscars. And Devil's Due, which is rubbish.
Wolf of Wall Street, I have to say, is the first film this year that I'm really excited to see. Because it looks fantastic.
If you can sit through just over 3 hours.
Of Leonardo DiCaprio.
But I have yet to read one bad review of it.
That's true. I mean, I've got a personal distaste for him. I've never understood why.
For DiCaprio?
Yeah, I don't like anything he's been in.
Really?
I like Gangs of New York, but I don't like him in it.
Well, that's interesting.
But I was told today that, I hope I'm getting the right movie, that it's a bit like Goodfellas in a different era.
Because it's being likened to Goodfellas. Apparently, okay. It's that good.
With that, and obviously it's Scorsese, so it's got the same kind of his take on it.
Yeah.
Jonah Hill, I'd watch it for him.
Really?
Yeah.
Because what's going on?
Because I want to see how he treats an acting class rather than a slapstick. Okay. You know what I mean? Because he's up for Best Supporting Actor. He must have done something right.
Okay, now, in the last couple of weeks, Stuart, we've had the BAFTA nominations and we've had the Golden Globe Awards, all building up to the granddaddy of them all, the big one.
WrestleMania.
Yeah.
The Razzies.
The Razzies. the Oscars. The Oscars, which, of course, the nominations were announced today.
Yep.
Now, you've had a chance to look at them. I've read through them very briefly as well. Tell us what's happening.
Well, to be honest, there isn't any major shocks in there. If you look at the technical categories, like Gia said earlier on, Jackass is up for best makeup, hair and makeup, so is the Lone Ranger as well.
Lone Ranger's probably going to win that, but could you imagine if Jackass won an Oscar, no matter what it's for?
No, I think it's going to go to Dallas Buyers Club. It's going to win that one, just because of Jared Leto. Transforming a male into a female, especially a female with a person who looks like a female.
Yeah. And is he not up for Best Supporting Actor as well?
Yeah, he is. I mean, that's weird. And also, if you look at, which category is it? The Lone Ranger is also up for Best Visual Effects.
Now, it could win that because as much as it's a crap movie, it does. Sometimes you don't realise the effects are effects, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, but still, you could have taken that out and put in something like Pacific Rim.
Yeah. Is that not... Oh, goodness, I didn't even... You know, I'd forgotten it was this year.
Yeah, because even take out The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug, because apart from Smaug himself, the special effects aren't that good, to be honest. Then Gravity, Iron Man 3, Star Trek Into Darkness, yes, but take out Lone Ranger and The Hobbit and put in Pacific Rim and just leave it as a four-movie category rather than what's in there.
I'm not trying to filter up. Do you think that Gravity is going to take it? Because obviously,
yeah, it will.
It has to, doesn't it?
Yeah. And animated feature. It's a three-horse race, in my opinion, because The Croods is just being thrown in there as a good measure. Ernest and Celeste. I've never seen it. And Despicable Me 2. Brilliant. Frozen. Amazing. And just because I think it deserves it with Beanie's last film, The Wind Rises, which is Hayao Miyazaki's final ever film. So
I think that's what's going to push it over the edge. I think that sentimentality might just get it.
He is loved at the Oscars because Spirited Away was the first Japanese film to be nominated for an Oscar. An animated film anyway that was nominated for an Oscar. So he is loved by that. And like with it being his last film, he'll never get nominated ever again. So maybe. But I think I would be happy with Despicable Me 2 or Frozen for that.
And Frozen's up for a couple of score and soundtrack ones as well, isn't it?
Yeah. If you look at the main ones, director David O. Russell for American Hustle, Alfonso Cuarón, Gravity, Alexander Payne, Nebraska, I think is a bit out of his league here. Steve McQueen, 12 Years a Slave, and Martin Scorsese, The Wolf of Wall Street. It's a difficult one to choose from, but for me it's a two-horse race. It's between Cuarón and McQueen. Because of if you look at 12 Years a Slave, yeah, it was gone and a lot of critical praise, but it started to build up and steamroll when it comes to the awards, and it's become a much more of a front runner in the awards. It was Gravity, but now because 12 Years a Slave has been seen by a lot more people, it seems to be gaining a lot more towards the awards. So I think for that, it's between 12 Years a Slave for McQueen and Gravity for Cuarón. Best actor is, again, I think it's an open race, this one. Christian Bale, Bruce Dern, Leonardo DiCaprio, Chiwetel Ejiofor, Matthew McConaughey. Who would have thought Matthew McConaughey nominated for an Oscar for best actor? if you look at his stuff 10 years ago, or even 5 years ago, you would never have thought that he would be nominated for Best Actor in anything. But he's proven to be a brilliant...